middle of our worship series, Angels Among Us, and we invite you to take out your cell phone. You have your cell phone, go ahead and take that out. Mine's a little cracked, it's okay. Now, in your bulletin, for those who don't know what the hashtag is, there is a great description. If you do know what a hashtag is, we invite you to keep your phone out throughout the service. Take pictures or video of moments or scenes that spark your imagination and grasp your attention, and tweet those, post them on Facebook with the hashtag Angels Among Us, Not Be Afraid, St. Mark's UCC, three different hashtags. So don't worry about having your cell phones up. It's good. It's welcome here. We just ask that you silence them so that you get a special message or somebody's trying to get in touch with you. Everybody doesn't hear it. Now I invite you to take a deep breath with me. And let's center and silence ourselves as we join in on worship.
Every angel sings to you, "Do not be afraid," as an opening line. But perhaps no one needed to hear this line more than Joseph. What was happening to him was the kind of stuff that ruins lives. As a man in that time, he had all the rights in the world to abandon Mary and preserve his dignity when he learned of her pregnancy. The stakes were high, but the angel's message of encouragement was to see a difficult circumstance, not with dread, but with joy.
Thank you. Holy living God, blessed Jesus, guiding spirit, alight within us your flame of joy this day. Grant us openness to hear your message. Grant us courage to be your messengers in the world, creating more joy in the midst of fear.
And with the angel messengers above us and within us, we sing, we are people of God's peace.
Do not be afraid to wed Mary and sneak off and sleep with someone else. Rather, she conceived the baby she now carries through the miraculous wonder-working of the Holy Spirit. She will have a son, and you will name him Jesus, which means the Lord saves. Because this Jesus is the person who will save all of his people.
Joseph woke up from his dream and did exactly what the messenger had told him to do. He married Mary and brought her into his home as his wife, though he did not consummate their marriage until after her son was born.
When the baby is born, I shall name him Jesus, Savior Emmanuel, God with us.
Years and years ago, Isaiah, a prophet of Israel, foretold the story of Mary, Joseph, and Jesus in this way.
Thank you. of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be exalted, and every mountain and hill brought low. The crooked places shall be made straight, and the rough places smooth. The glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken.
I, the Lord, have called you in righteousness. I will take hold of your hand. I will keep you and will make you to be a covenant for the people and a light for the Gentiles. Hear this promise from Scripture. The desert and the parched land will be glad. The wilderness will rejoice and blossom like the crocus. It will burst into bloom. It will rejoice greatly and shout for joy. All will see the glory of the Lord and the splendor of our God.
Thank you.
For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace.
In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them. and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on a stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven.
Thank you.
know if you've noticed, but in the last few weeks, stores have been really crowded. There's sort of a mass insanity going on. And our front step seems to be an accumulation of packages that keep showing up from shopping online. And sometimes, in the midst of all the chaos of the upcoming season, one of the things that is missing is a sense of joy. The holiday seems to be more oppressive than it seems to be fun or joyful. Except in church. I keep coming to church and seeing signs of joy. This afternoon, people are going to be picking up packages, people in need, but we've helped give them gifts for their children. And there will be joy on Christmas because of the efforts of the people here. I saw people at Closed Closet yesterday filled with joy because people were serving them and helping them. I saw people sitting in the soup kitchen yesterday filled with joy because they were being fed and treated well. And today at worship has been a time of just amazing joy, listening to the choir sing. Haven't they been just, I wouldn't even say they're great, they're magnificent. They really are. What I appreciate about church, and what I appreciate about this church, is we remember what this season is all about. And one of the things we remember over and over again is that it's a season of joy. There was a child born. Not that one. This guy was born in 1674 in England. And his name was Isaac. And Isaac was a sickly child. While all the other children played and played sports and did all sorts of things, Isaac was too sickly. Then he grew up, and he was still very frail, very sickly. He went into the ministry and excelled in his studies. But he never quite was able to be a pastor. The demands of being the pastor of a church were too intense for him. So he gave it up. And even though he was frail and sickly, Isaac had a joyful spirit about him. And he would go to church, and he was a very poetic type. And he was what was called in England a nonconformist. He didn't belong to the Church of England. He was Protestant and would go to church and hear hellfire and brimstone sermons and hear hymns that just drove him crazy because he felt there was no hope in them or joy. His friends all said, Isaac, instead of complaining about the hymns, why don't you take a crack at hymn writing? So he took a crack at hymn writing. Turns out Isaac was pretty darn good at writing hymns. He ended up changing English hymnody a great deal. He wrote over 600 hymns. Many of them are in our hymnal to this day. Whenever you sing a hymn like, O God, our help in ages past, that's a hymn that Isaac wrote. But Isaac, in the year 1719, was having a really difficult year. And people said to him, are you down and depressed? And Isaac said, no, I'm feeling joy. So I'm feeling joy, a joy to the world because the Lord has come. And Isaac said, And so he penned his most favorite hymn, his most famous hymn of all. He penned, "Joy to the world, the Lord has come." You may be familiar with it. To him, we still sing. And to him, that Isaac Watts gave as a gift to the church, as a gift to Christianity, because he knew, believed, that people needed to celebrate the joy that God has given. It's because of people like Isaac Watts who have the course of Christian history that, yes, I believe that there are angels among us.
Offer our needs before
before you because we know you listen to us, and we know that you hear all of our prayers. We know that your healing hand is always present. We don't always understand it. We don't always accept what is going to happen. Let us know that your healing hand is always with us and always upon all those we pray for. And in this moment, we pray for all those in need of peace. We hear the message of God. Joyful things. One of the joyful things, I've got two joyful things. One is, I know, I'm on a roll. All right, yeah. One is I appreciate the choir and all our musicians because of the hard work for today. But I don't know if you know it, but next Sunday is Christmas Eve. And they're working on that too. So I appreciate all of that. Secondly, I appreciate Sandy and all the kids because I know they're working next week because I don't know if you know it, but next week is Christmas Eve. And they're working really hard. The third thing I appreciate is our worship team and all the people who have been participants because we've gotten scripts and all these things. We've had people rehearsing so they can do the scripture well. We've had angels coming down. We've had lighting. We've had all sorts of things. So I'm really appreciative of all the people and joyful, full of joy over that. So that's three. I know we have one from the deacons. Alan Mason was going to share.
Good morning. I am so very, very proud of St. Mark's this morning. Yes. We took on a tremendous challenge. 200 gifts were on the tree back here. Our congregation got all 200 gifts, wrapped and wrapped beautifully. 200 gifts. And those gifts will go to children that need them in just an hour or two across the way in our fellowship hall. That is quite an accomplishment. It means a lot of people and a lot of angels among us to make something like that happen.
Thank you.
For
as we share our offering with God and God's people.
So that by the light of our love, they may see the glory of God in
not good. I invite everyone to rise. When this Christmas song comes along your path this week, as it most probably will, it's going to happen momentarily. We'll be singing it again next week. You might be hearing it on the radio or in stores. But stop for a moment and remember the reason for the season. We can know joy right now, even in the midst of fear and in the midst of chaos. For God desires so much for each of us and for all humanity that God sent Jesus, Emmanuel. And the Spirit continues with us always and forevermore as we join and sing joy to the world.
As we sing to one another the message